Hi, I'm J.John. Welcome to Facing the Canon. My guest this week is Dr. Michael Youssef, Senior Minister of Church of the Apostles in Atlanta with a global ministry. Dr. Michael Youssef, welcome to Facing the Canon.
Thank you so much. I hope you don't shoot me too hard.
No, it is our honor to have you, honestly, on the program. And well, let's start at the beginning.
Sure.
You were born in Egypt.
That's right.
Now, there's a lovely story about your mother.
Yes.
Who was carrying you.
Yep.
Who was advised by the doctors to stop the pregnancy. Tell us about that.
Well, I grew up in an evangelical home, a very Bible-believing home. I still can't remember. I can't even imagine anything like this would happen now. But my father, because we're eight of us, eight children, and my father did not believe in democracy. He said, no democracies in Egypt, so there was no voting. He said, if you need an opinion, I'll give it to you. So family altar at 10 o'clock every night, it was just not, I mean, even my older brothers, 19, 17 years older than me, they would have to come home. They were successful bankers for the, I'm giving you that background because know that the godly, God-loving, Christ-worshiping family. And so before I was born, they already had six or seven kids, and my mother's health really was not at best. And three doctors have advised her, you must have an abortion. You cannot have this baby.
Yes.
Your health will not make it. He didn't even make through the birth. Well, she did, and agreed to go and have the procedure with my dad, until the pastor of our Wesleyan church that my parents belonged to came and knocked on the door early hours in the morning of the operation. And he said, please don't go through with this. I was disturbed about this all night. And I believe it's from the Lord that he or she will serve the Lord. So a godly woman that my mother was, she said, absolutely, I'm going to trust God. And if he takes me home, he takes me home. I'm going to deliver this baby. And so in 1948, I was born. And
Healthy and your mother was healthy.
Was healthy, and God gave her 16 more years for the joy and the privilege for me to know her and to see her, what a great prayer warrior she was.
And that also, Michael, coincided with you coming and surrendering to Jesus.
Yes, it happened that I gave my life to Christ. I was rebellious. I'm really rebelled. I just did not like this whole idea that I was called to preach when all my brothers are successful bankers and having suits flown in from Italy and chauffeur-driven cars and I'm going to be what? And so I thought if I rebel, I'll become damaged goods and God can't use me. But miraculously, God brought me to himself on the 4th of March, 1964. I gave my life to Christ. And
was there a particular, what was the thing that connected you?
Well, I'll tell you very, very, very quickly. My older brother, he's the third. He was 11 years older than me. He was literally the number two in the federal treasury. He was literally writing the national budget. And he was as brilliant mathematician. I was as dumb. I thought that if I did not know the story of my birth, I think I was adopted because I flunked math. I wasn't very good. So I would go to him for help. Well, this time he blackmailed me. In a godly way.
Yes.
He said, I will help you with this, because the exam was the next day. If you go to a meeting with me tonight, because there was a Lebanese evangelist preaching in a revival. I said, well, I said, I agreed, but I really had no intention of going. Finally, I said, I'll tell you what, I'll go with you, sit in the back. As soon as the service is over, I'm gone. He said, okay, that's fine. But as it turned out, the preacher was preaching from the book of Hosea. And he was talking about a child that's going to be called Lorahama, or I'll have no mercy. And he talked about how the door of mercy is now, but that door of mercy is going to be closed. And where will you be? And that immediately resonated with me. So instead of being the first one to bolt out after the sermon, I was the first one to come forward.
Wonderful.
And gave my life to Christ. And that was one of the most amazing things. I sat down, wrote a letter to my mother who was in the hospital, and told her about what God has done. And so she kept that letter under her pillow. Literally, every visitor would come and said, read this. God answered my prayers. Now I can really die in peace. So she died in July of the same year.
That's amazing.
I came to the Lord in March. She died in July. And so I've always, you know, even though after her death, I kind of began to waffle a little bit. I said, well, maybe I need to do this. I can serve God if I go and make money like my siblings, and I will serve God that way. But eventually, I had literally escaped from the country because the situation was really dire.
That's right. There was the Six-Day War.
Six-Day War in 67 with Israel, as some people may know the story, but it was abysmal time.
Yes.
For anybody who's living in Egypt at the time.
Yeah. And so you got a temporary visa to go to Australia.
Australia already accepted me as an immigrant. I was 19, wasn't even 19 years old. And so I asked the ambassador, who was a friend of a friend, the Australian ambassador, if they send my file to the embassy in Beirut. He said, oh yeah, no problem at all. So I got this temporary visa to go to Beirut. But if I had not left the country in 48 hours, everything is basically will be finished. It happened to be a Muslim feast holiday and a lot of people traveling. And they said there are 50 people who are waitlisted. But if I did not go on that plane, that particular flight at 5 o'clock in the morning, I would not have been sitting in front of you today.
No.
50 people. And there was only one cancellation. And when I heard the station manager at the airport of the airline calling my name, I mean, it was the most amazing thing. Is not really a good word. I mean, it's supernatural, we know that. A distant relative that my brother wrote a letter to, he told him what time I'm arriving, and it was touch and go whether he'll meet me or not. I tried to get some hotel accommodation, and I couldn't, so I said, I'll get there and find something. But he was waiting for me at the airport, and took me to his home for 3 or 4 days. That was on a Sunday evening. By Wednesday, I was in a job. I had a job in North Sydney working in a telephone company.
That's right, because you met a clergyman who said, I know where to introduce you.
Exactly.
So again, more divine appointments.
Amazing, yes. Because there was a scholar, you might have read some of his books, named Ken Bailey.
Yes.
Ken Bailey literally he grew up in my hometown with my brothers.
Yes.
And so I knew him very well. So I landed in Beirut, and I told him, you know, I'm on my way to Sydney. He said, there's only one place you need to go to if you're going to study for ministry, and it's Moore Theological College off on Sydney University campus. And I said, well, he said, it's an Anglican. I said, Anglo what? Because there weren't many Anglicans in Egypt to this day, very, very small minority. But the Presbyterians, they're very large. They're the largest Protestant group in Egypt, and that's where my background. So I took a Presbyterian missionary's word for it and landed in Moore College with a letter of introduction to Donald Robinson,
yes,
who at the time was the vice principal.
Yes.
Later became the Archbishop of Sydney.
Yeah.
He was so amazing. He and Mari, his wife, literally took me in. And like part of the family, and they acted as my parents 2 years later at my wedding.
Amazing. Yes, and you met your wife,
yes,
Elizabeth.
Admitted, the third week I was in the country.
At church. was it her mother that invited you for lunch?
Right, she kind of felt sorry for me. This man from Egypt, young man. I was 19 years old, about to turn 20. And so she asked me if I have any place to go for lunch. And I said, no, not really. Would you like to come? And I said, yes. Normally I'm very shy. I would say, yes. No, thank you, I'm fine. But I did go, and she rushed home, I guess, to get something ready. And the pastor's wife said, this is Elizabeth Bailey, who is going to walk you to the house. She's the daughter of that lovely lady who invited you to lunch. And as they say, the rest is history.
That was it.
Yeah.
And you've been married, what, 50
One years? Yes,
51
yeah.
years. Yes, so you've got the gold medal.
Yeah. So this was 53 years ago.
Yes.
When we met.
So you did go to Moore Theological College.
I did.
You trained for the ministry.
Yes, yeah.
You then.
I was ordained in Sydney by Archbishop Marcus Sloan.
I knew Marcus Sloan.
You would, yes.
In fact, I preached, and he was a retired.
Yes.
And we spoke afterwards, and he was very encouraging.
He's an amazing man. I ran into him at the airport. He was 92. I was preaching in Brisbane, and he was in the same plane. And I walked up to him. I didn't know he remembered me. He looked at me and said, how is things in Atlanta? I said, so Marcus, I'm so glad to see you. And this is just one of those things. Sydney Diocese has been a blessing to me.
Yes.
Moore College has been a blessing to me. I dedicated one of my books to the teachers at Moore College who taught me the scripture and to love and respect the word of God and to interpret it accurately.
Yes.
All of these things instilled in me that's something I owe.
Absolutely.
To those men.
Yeah, and it was building blocks. But then you did you feel a call, you and Elizabeth, to go to America? What was it that took you to America?
Well, initially it was a feeling that I needed some more training, and there was a man by the name of Professor Paul Hebert. Paul Hebert was a cultural anthropologist, son of a missionary, and a missionary himself to India. He gave up professorship at Seattle University, Washington, to go to the School of World Mission.
Yeah, at Fuller Seminary.
Pasadena at Fuller. And I wanted to study under him. And then I received a scholarship. So we ended up going there to study. Meanwhile, I met a man by the name of John Haggai, and he just kept saying, "You need to come and you're going to succeed me." And I said, "Wait a minute, I'm 30. I was 36. I was 28."
When initially,
yes. I was 28, and we prayed. Archbishop Marcus Sloan had a place for me in Sydney. He wouldn't even let me resign. He said, take a leave of absence, come back. I want you to come back. And my wife was only child, and our children were her parents' only grandchildren.
Yes.
And so we really had a tug to go back to Sydney.
Sure.
But nonetheless, when we felt God's calling to go to Atlanta and accept the leadership of this ministry, we went there in 1978. And with their 9 years serving there until God began to move in my heart to plant a church.
Yes. So if we just backtrack, you went to Fuller Seminary.
Yes.
You also then did a doctorate.
Now what happened, I finished the master's at
yes.
Fuller, and then I moved to Atlanta.
Yes.
To take this. And
with the Haggai Institute.
And when I was in Atlanta, I applied for a doctoral PhD program
yes.
at Emory University. A dear friend of mine, Jerry Bevan, who many people wouldn't remember, he was really the kind of the alter ego of Billy Graham in the early days.
Yeah.
He did the Harringate Crusade here in 58. But Jerry Bevan became a very dear friend, and he said, you know, don't do another degree in another Christian school. Go and do it in a secular university. That way you'll have
yes.
credibility with the secular world. And that was a wise advice
yes.
because I went and enrolled at Emory, and it was a great opportunity for me to
sure.
to be in a secular environment doing in social anthropology, which is totally different from preaching. But it really helped me understand things that I would not have understood had I just been in the theology world.
Sure.
Yeah.
But it's all building blocks, isn't it? It's all little links in the chain. And as you said, you then felt prompted by the Lord to plant a church.
Yes, and that was in 1984, 85. The burden just became so, it got heavier by the day. And the more I said, Lord, this, I can't do this. This is not my, I don't know even how to go about planting a church. And the Lord said, well, just trust me and obey me. Trust me and obey me. In fact, I wrote my biography called Trust and Obey.
Yes.
Because that's really the story of my life is God said, you trust me, you obey me, and I'll do the rest. And he did.
I know. And I can highly recommend the book. It gives you more details of the story, behind the story. But tell us a bit about the Church of the Apostles. How did it end up being called that?
Well, this is really amazing because, as everybody knows, the Episcopal Church has moved away from biblical mores. They moved away from the 39 Articles of Faith, moved away from Anglican Reformation and Anglican teaching, and the church was drifting in such a way. But I thought maybe, just maybe, God is calling me to have a mission church in Atlanta. To the up and out.
Yes.
And those people I've been kind of befriended, and in the 10 years I've been in the city, I got to know the business leaders, and the two bishops at the time said, you know, we got rid of evangelicals in this diocese. We don't want any more evangelicals. We're not going to start one. And I said, that's fine. If you say no, you can say yes or no, because that way that's my fleece. Finally said, okay, yes, do it, but don't leave your daytime job because you're going to fail miserably.
Yeah, so they weren't very encouraging.
Oh, not at all.
No.
They just knew I was going to fail. And they sort of get it out of his system, and he'll probably go back to his job. And then I said to one of the bishops, I said, well, I'm a man under authority, and I'm under your authority, even though you're not exalting me to righteousness, but what do we call the church? He said, you know, you believe that gospel stuff and all the preaching of the apostles. Why don't you call yourselves the Church of the Apostles? That's how it came about. And we ended up being called the Church of the Apostles. I said, sounds good to me. That's what we're going to be called. And
it was, I mean, the church now, as I see it, I mean, it's amazing.
Yeah.
The building itself.
Yeah.
Can tell us a little bit about how many it seats.
Well, we seat about 3,000 people. And at the time when we were part of the Episcopal Church, when I said, actually I didn't, one of my elders in whom I confided that God has given me a vision for a 3,000 seat, he told the bishop, and he became so mad and angry. He said, you cannot be bigger than the cathedral. It's not Episcopal to do that.
Yeah.
And I said, well, that's fine. And but it was constant a tug of war. They refused to accept my preaching. And no matter, I point out to them to the 39 Articles of Faith, and the bishop says, "That we don't believe those anymore. One time he said to me, he said, I feel sorry for you. I said, well, good. Tell me why. He said, you are like a student who enrolled in college and the curriculum changed and you don't know about it. He said, that's what you are in the Episcopal Church. The curriculum changed. We don't believe the Bible. We don't even believe the doctrine, original doctrine of the Anglican Church. We have moved away from all that. But you're stuck in the past. I said, well, good.
But of course, you knew the original script.
Absolutely.
And the original script is the same. And God is the same yesterday, today, and forever.
Absolutely.
So you pressed on.
I did. And I would not compromise. No. I would not press. In fact, they tried to persuade me with positions and this and that. And I said, I don't do anything.
No.
I'm a pastor at heart. I want a pastor. I don't want positions. I don't want to be a bishop. I don't want to be any.
You just want to pastor people.
I just want to pastor
and lead people to Christ. How many people come to the church?
Now, we have about 3,000 members, and our members are very active. They
Yes.
They come, you know, in America, you can have a church of 8,000 people, but you only have 1,800 in attendance. That's kind of the American way.
You've got active people. Well,
we actually got active people. Most of, we put our new members through the hoops. And I tell them every time I receive a group of new members, I thank them for their perseverance. Yes. But we want to ensure that they are members in the heavenly church.
Of course.
More than they're just members of a local church.
Yeah.
And so interviews and testimonies and all these things are very important to make sure that they know Jesus, they love Jesus, and they're going to be involved, become
Absolutely.
Active members. And so we have people, whether it be there 30 years or 30 days, the ground is level.
Yes.
Yeah.
And what I love about you, Michael, is that you think globally, but you also act locally.
Absolutely.
And you set up Leading the Way.
Yes.
Tell us a bit about Leading the Way. Tell us about your heart and passion for global communication of the truth of God.
Well, prior to planting the church, I was traveling the globe, literally going around the world three or four times a year, speaking on campuses, speaking in cathedrals, speaking in churches. So I already have a global vision. And so when the Lord began to lay on my heart a planting of a church, and I remember, I said, Lord, how can I leave a globe ministry to be in the local church? And the Lord said, just trust me and obey me. And so the global vision has never left me, but I just wasn't sure when and how. And again, God just intervened, brought people into my life, and literally pushed me into starting a media ministry, and from the media ministry locally become the global ministry. I always had a passion and a desire to impact the world. You know, when
I like the little also divine stories. Wasn't there a story about a farmer who felt that he should sell his farm and give you some, like a significant amount?
Well, the whole amount.
Yes.
Yeah. When I was in the Middle East doing an evangelistic outreach one time, I got the vision in 2004 that there's a need for a Christian channel, television channel. Between 2004 and March of 2009, when we launched, I went through a lot of, and I would say to the Lord, I said, well, forgive me, but I'm going to put a fleece. I don't have the money to start the channel. So I'm going to pray. If you send the money and somebody will say, this is specifically for the channel without my asking them.
Yes, that's right.
Then I know it's from you. And lo and behold, a friend of mine from the Midwest called me. I've known him for many, many years. And he said, are you okay? I said, I'm fine. Why? He said, well, Lord just kept waking me up and disturbing me, my sleep about you. And I said, well, I'm doing great. He said, do you have needs? Do you have... Finally, it dawned on me, and I said, well, God has given me that vision, but I told the Lord I'm going to wait until He proves it. But He said, that's what it was, because the Lord kept saying to me, sell your farm and give the money to Michael. I said, well, so as it turned out, he did sell the farm, gave us some money, and then how we launched Kingdom Sat, Malakot in Arabic.
Yes.
It's in 194 million Arabic-speaking homes in North Africa, all the way to Iraq. And again, when we started, we just put few programs together, some from the West, some from the East. It was only a four-hour program, repeated or looped six times. But because of the response, now it's 12-hour programming every day, looped twice. At nighttime, so that everyone would watch the program in a prime time.
What a wonderful investment that farmer made.
Amen.
He's a hero of the faith.
He is.
So
indeed.
Now there is biblical teaching that is available in the Arab world, in their languages.
Yep. Even the few English speakers are translated into Arabic.
Wonderful.
We have a team in Atlanta. They're all from Syria, from Egypt, from different parts of the world, happen to be in Atlanta, and they've been in this type of ministry. So we assembled the team, and they're excellent in translating and either dubbing or just the subtitling. And so we were 50-50 East-West English-Arabic. Now the English is about 10 to 12%. And all the other programs, there are Lebanese evangelists, North Africans from Algiers, Morocco, Tunisia, Iraqis, Egyptians, of course, a lot of Egyptian, because that's the largest Christian population of 15 million. So there are many Christian leaders in Egypt that we put on air.
And I know many people who are from a Muslim background.
Yes.
Are having dreams
yes.
and visions
yes.
seeing Jesus.
Yeah.
And they tune in
yep.
to your teaching.
Yep.
And when you talk about Jesus, they go, yes.
That's the one I saw in my dream.
That's the one yeah. I saw in my dream.
Yep. Yeah. And it's really this movement, it's the Holy Spirit movement. It wasn't organized. The people were praying for it. I know many of them. Started in 82. They said, Lord, we cannot evangelize outside the walls of the church. So would you show them dreams and visions? So then it started and then took off even in Indonesia, all the way from Indonesia to Morocco. People seeing dreams of Jesus coming to them said, I love you, including an ISIS leader in the Middle East. He's now an evangelist. He saw a dream of Jesus and the blood dripping from an envelope that he handed him. And he called one of our lines and one of the follow-up teams. And it was just amazing stories, I can tell you. Thousands and thousands of people coming to Christ. And I've been invited to be on an Arab satellite. And so when we asked, you know, I mean, we're a Christian channel, so we know that. And they said, but we watched you for years, and we know you do not attack us, you do not attack our religion, you don't attack our prophet, you don't attack anybody, you lift up your Jesus. And I said, that's the vision. They got it. They really got it. I said, the vision was kingdom sat, malakot sat, is to lift up Jesus and he'll draw all men to himself. And that's just been a remarkable journey.
It has been a remarkable journey. Dr. Michael Youssef, I could talk to you all day, and our time is up, but thank you so much for joining us
pleasure.
On Facing the Canon.
My pleasure. Thank you for having me.
Wasn't that wonderful? Honestly, I could talk to this man all day, just telling stories. Well, the good news is there's a part two with Dr. Michael Youssef. Please join us next week as we continue this conversation. Thank you very much for joining us on Facing the Canon.